This is a production of Cornell University.
From there. So, one of the things I wanted to do, being that this is not an entomology crowd, is do a little bit of Lady Beetle 101. And that is just to say that often you'll hear ladybugs, or in most of the world the vernacular is ladybird or ladybird beetle, but it's all the same there. It's the family Coccinellidae. They are important predators, and they're beetles, not bugs or birds, and they're not all ladies. There, it's about half and half the sex ratio. So, as I was pondering how I wanted to approach this talk, it occurred to me that there's been, so what I work with is native lady beetles, and I'm interested in them especially, and immigrant lady beetles. And it occurred to me that there's been a lot in the news lately about immigration, and so maybe this relatively simple realm of international politics could be a model for the more complex world of lady beetle biology. And so I just set up a little dichotomy here of thinking about the foreign lady beetles. Are they hardworking immigrants that are doing this important ecological service, or are they bad hombres? So let's just see about how different people define those terms. If I can, okay, play that again.
There are also the millions of women and men whose names history may not remember, but whose actions helped make us who we are, who built this country hand by hand, brick by brick.
Oh, and for you younger people, this is a past president, by the way. Okay. Okay, so that's the idea that immigrants are these hardworking immigrants that have helped build this country, and that might be one way that lady beetles function. But here's another way to think about immigrants.
Bad hombres here, and we're going to get them out.
Okay, so there's the dichotomy. Are these immigrants, these hardworking individuals that have helped build the country, or are they bad hombres that we need to get out? And so part of what I want to do is think about lady beetles in that context, and depending on what the answer is, it'll maybe point the way that we can optimally manage or conserve those creatures. Okay, so in general, insects are very hardworking, and they provide a lot of ecological services that we need in everywhere in the world. And we generally, they do those services without a lot of input from us, as long as they're not hindered in those roles. So in 2006, Mace Vaughn and I, who was a graduate of Cornell, estimated the economic value of the ecological services that insects provide. And this is just the value of services that the ones we estimated were just for native insects. So if you added the ones that have been imported, it would be probably double. Okay. So the one obviously that I focus on are ladybugs, and their main role is in biological control. They're not the only biological control agent, although they're an important one, but other members of this family also feed on fungus, and they do some decomposition. They can be food for wildlife, those that aren't chemically protected, and they can play a role in pollination. Pollination's not just bees, there's other things. So clearly this is just ladybugs. Another big aspect to that there's, you can think of other insect groups, bees notably for pollination, beetles and flies for decomposition, and the list goes on. But I'm going to focus again on just the ladybugs. Okay, so thinking first about what role ladybugs are playing in our country, especially foreign ladybugs. And this is, ladybugs can eat a lot of different, it's mostly soft-bodied prey. So they can feed on the eggs of a lot of different agricultural pests. They can feed on larvae, but their favorite food is aphids. And one of the biggest and most recent aphid pests in the U.S. is the soybean aphid. And so soybean aphid, shown here, is we have a foreign crop. It's not originally from North America. We have a foreign pest, and not surprisingly, the top four coccinellids, if I wax into coccinellids, that's the same as ladybugs. The top four species that provide suppression of this pest are all foreigners. They're all brought in. So in that sense, here, this is a good example of them being hardworking immigrants, right? They're playing this really important role, and in a sense, they've been reconnected with something that they would have eaten back in its home range. Okay, so this is what we would hope to see with a foreign lady beetle. And I should just note that all these were brought in. They didn't come in on their own. They were all released here. Some question about Harmonia, whether it partly came in on its own, but we'll get to that later. Okay, so that's one good example of an important system where lady beetles are doing their thing, and it's very positive. But what about in a broader sense about how foreign lady beetles do in terms of suppressing pests, how effective they are versus the native lady beetles that were here before we brought those in? And so here's one comparison that was done by one of my grad students, Evan Hokey, and he looked at the 7-spot lady beetle compared to the 9-spot lady beetle, and he was looking at predation on the pea aphid, which is another big aphid pest, not so much in peas, but it's big in alfalfa and forage crops. And what he found was that the 7-spot does consume significantly more aphids, and it causes more to drop off the plant. So again, here is a foreign lady beetle that's doing even more than the native one that would be in a very similar niche. And if you... So that was the 7-spot, which was one of the main foreign lady beetles. The most common lady beetle in the U.S. and across the world, which I'll come back to, is Harmonia axeritis. It's the multicolored Asian lady beetle. And that's the one that I showed on the leaf eating the soybean aphid. And so a very large group, which I was somewhere a part of, looked at the sort of biology and ecology of this group across the world. And if you look at predation rates of this beetle and combine that with the predation rates of the 7-spot and other foreign species compared to what it would have been for native species, you can come up with this index, which is how much potential is there for pest suppression, right? And it has to do with a little bit how they forage, but mostly with the voracity, what their predation rate is, right? And we can look at how the coccinellid complex has changed over time and then calculate this index over time for all those different species and see how the suppression potential has changed as these foreign species have gotten more and more common. So let's take a look at that. So this is that index, and it just shows, I won't go into exactly how you calculate it, but it just shows that if you look at how the species composition changes and you know what their predation rates are, which most are published, the herbivore suppression potential has gone up as the proportion of foreign lady beetles has increased. So again, this is evidence that we've got some really hardworking immigrants. At a very basic level, there's more herbivore suppression potential than there was before we had those foreign lady beetles. Okay. So that's sort of the good side. Now let's think about what's the evidence for the other side of the coin. So somebody said these look like blueberries, and they do, but actually this is grapes. And this is, again, our friend Harmonia axeritis. And one of the things that it does doesn't actually have to do with pest suppression, but in the fall, right when they're getting near harvest time, the Harmonia will get on ripe grapes. And the way the harvesting works, the Harmonia get harvested along with the grapes, and it gets pulled into the vats where they're going to, you know, the people come with their bare feet and squash them, and they're going to make the wine, right? And so one aspect of a lot of lady beetles, but it's especially pronounced with Harmonia, is they have something called reflex bleeding. And so if they get hassled or molested in any way, they exude this sticky, yellow, really smelly substance from their joints. And so when they get harvested along with the grapes, that gets into the wine, and it's called taint. And then it loses its value, and in some cases becomes unsellable. I have to say, we've had students in our IPM class actually do this and put different levels of the taint in there. I must not be a wine connoisseur. I don't taste it that much. Tony, he's originally from Italy. He could taste it. So maybe it shows I'm generally drinking too low of a quality of wine to make any difference. But the point is that here is one negative aspect of potentially of this foreign species. Okay. Another thing on the sort of negative side, and again this is it's called the multicolored Asian lady beetle, so I called it the multicolored menace, is if you have ever had ladybugs in your home or seen them in a building, they are almost inevitably this Asian lady beetle. It's the one lady beetle that has the behavior of coming into houses or buildings in the winter. None of the native species did that. And so does it really do a lot of damage? No, it's not a structural pest, and it doesn't transmit disease. But if it gets in these densities, it's a nuisance pest, right? And it can put out its yellow reflex bleeding substance, and that can stain different materials. And a very small but apparently growing segment of the population is actually allergic to the smell. Okay, again, that's vanishingly small, but there are people out there. So this again is on the bad side. All right. So there's a couple points on the good and a couple points on the bad. I wanted to step back a little bit and just look at another aspect beyond just direct interactions with humans for the bad side. And that is, if you look at the closed circles here, that's the number of adventive or foreign species coming into the U.S. And you can see it's just going up and up. And these are species that established. There's been several others that were released but haven't established. Okay. Then if you look at the open circles, that is the proportion of native species. So you can see, even early on, these foreign ones didn't do a whole lot. You had almost 100% natives. And then starting here, you really started to get this dip where you've got some really low numbers there. Now, what is causing this? It looks like there's some interaction here between the foreign species and the native species. Admittedly, this is like right around when disco music was popular, and a lot of bad stuff happened there, but it's probably not that's what it is. Okay, so are the foreign species having an impact on native species? Because that would be more evidence that maybe they're being bad hombres. So just to sort of go on with the idea that if you look at the two time periods, early on you had almost 100% natives. Later on, in the later time period, it's much lower, and they are significantly different. So there's been a significant change in the proportion of native species, and they have gone down. But in one way, what I say is beware the deceptive denominator. And what I mean by that is that maybe what's happening is there are just more lady beetles out there, right? That would be what you would hope, right? Is that you're bringing in these foreign lady beetles, but now you have more niches because you've got different crops or you have whatever there is. And so the proportion of natives is maybe going down just because now you've got a larger total, right? So that would be a positive thing. And so as I thought about that, one way that we addressed that is by looking at, there aren't many, but there are several long-term studies in the same system where you can look at the density of coccinellids or lady beetles pre-invasion or pre-release of the foreign ones, and you can look at it after, right? And so if what's happening is that the foreign ones are just adding to the total, then you would expect densities to be higher after. If the densities aren't higher after, it implies that it's sort of a zero-sum game, right? And then if the proportion of natives is going down and it's a zero-sum game, it means they're declining, and that's bad. Okay. Just to illustrate, historical reference: Zoroastrians were at some point chased out of Iran. And this, they're an interesting group because they were absolutely pluralistic and accepting of all kinds of races and religions. And so they were excluded or chased out of Iran. They went to India, but they didn't speak the language. And so this is the way that the story goes, at least. The leader, since they didn't speak the language, they wanted to come in the country. The leader of India gave him this full glass or bowl of milk, and he meant to imply, we're all full up. Sorry, there's no room for you here in India. And what they did is they added sugar to the bowl and gave it back. And the idea was, and this is the idea with lady beetles too, is that they didn't change the volume of the bowl, they just were able to add something to the system that made it sweeter. And so that's the idea with biocontrol, right? You're not trying to make it overflow, you're just trying to add something to the system. So is that indeed what happened? If you are bringing in foreign lady beetles, do you now see higher densities? And the answer is no. If you look at the long-term studies, and there's actually like a confidence interval here that didn't come out very well, but you can see that so this is in a proportion, right? So if you look at the top of the line here is the density post foreign lady beetle compared to the original density, right? And so if it's one, it means it didn't change at all. If it's lower, it means the density went down. If it's higher, it means the density went up. So if you look across all these different studies, and you do this in a way that you can statistically combine them all, then what you find is, in fact, the density hasn't gone up. And so it appears that it is sort of a zero-sum game. So if the proportion of natives is going down across a lot, that we have lots more studies that aren't long-term in comparison, but if it's going down, it appears that they're really declining. They're not just being added to by the foreign species. Okay. So that's the overall trend, is that when the foreign ones come in, the native ones decline. And so let's look at one specific example. Does anybody know what this one is? Not you, Tony. Anybody know what species this is? You all should know what this is. Okay. So this is the, that's a, it's all right. This is not a, entomology crowd. This is the nine-spot lady beetle, Coccinella novum notata. Why you should all know what that is because it is our official state insect in New York. Not just lady beetle as our, it, this species specifically. Okay, so it's got one spot, split spot here, four on each side. It's got this black line down the middle, which is fairly unique. And it's got across the neck shield, white, and then white all the way across the head. We call it the milk mustache. All those are very characteristic of this one species. So this is has sort of been our flagship species for the Lost Ladybug Project, and it's one that's really declined. Okay. So if you look at its former range, it used to be essentially everywhere, and it was very, very common throughout North America. And so and now it's declined. These are some of the few back in 2000, these were like the only places it had been found, and in those places, only a couple of individuals. So and within a few decades, a really sharp and rapid decline. So the problem is, how do you deal with, how do you get data on a species that's declined so quickly over such a broad area? So what we came up with is this idea of the Lost Ladybug Project. And the Lost Ladybug Project is a citizen science project where we send, we educate people about lady beetles, and we recruit them to go out and take pictures and submit those back to us through the website. And then we have that data set of what's happening both with the natives and the foreign ones. And what the beauty of doing this with ladybugs is that we can identify almost 90% of the images that come into species, because it's all about the spot pattern. There are a few species that's not true and they're tougher, but mostly we can do that, even if the pictures aren't that great. Okay. Whoops. So this is very proud of. This is a group of young students, actually won Jane Goodall's Roots and Shoots Young Filmmaker Contest with this film about lady. Let me just play a little bit of it because it's really cool. And it tells about how the project works.
One more? Or is that pretty?
Okay, I think that's almost over. Guitar at the end. Okay. So sort of simple animation, but really telling, I think, a lot of important lessons there about what's happening with ladybugs and how to do the project and what their role is. So using this and other ways of recruiting, we've gotten almost, I think we're up to almost 40,000 identified images of lady beetles. And for each of those images, we have where and when it was collected and what kind of habitat it was collected in. So why do we get sort of different data from this citizen science project than we do from conventional surveys or conventional science? And one of the reasons is that we tend to get a lot of singletons. People will be out, they find a ladybug, they've heard of the project, they send that in. Okay, so what happens is that the citizen science data tends to be broad, and the conventional science data tends to be deep. So you tend to get very intense samples at a few locations. Citizen science, you get lots of samples from lots of locations. And so this just shows that again. The yellow dots are where, at that point, this has actually been quite a while back, that we got submissions from spotter submissions, and the pink were the surveys, and not surprisingly, clustered mostly around universities. Right. The other nice thing is that for when you talk about the LLP, Lost Ladybug Project, almost all of the observations come from non-ag situations. They're not necessarily going out in ag farmers' fields, and when and only 8% from ag situations, it's almost exactly flipped for conventional science, where most of the surveys that you find for conventional science are coming from ag fields. So what does that add up to? Well, for our nine spot, for C. novum notata, if you look at the C. novum notata per 1,000 observations, you're tending to find, it's not tending to, you get significantly more per observation that they find this rare species. This goes across several rare species than you do through the conventional science. And this is partly because they're so dispersed and partly because they're in so many different habitats. Okay, what do we find? Here's this is just a quick model that we ran looking across what we know of their densities over time. This one's obviously, or maybe not obvious, but this is a projected one. These are actually the data points. And so that looks pretty dire, right? And based on that, so let me just stop it there. So this is the broad scale data that we get from the Lost Ladybug Project. It allows us to make these kind of combined with published literature, it allows us to make these kinds of models of what's happening to its decline. The other thing that we can get from the Lost Ladybug Project is when a spotter, this is what we call our volunteers, finds a rare species, we can go out and collect with them, or sometimes they can send us some live specimens. We can get those in the lab, and then we can start to do directed experiments on maybe why the species is declining. This is one of my favorite spotters, Allison Yates. This has been maybe like 5 years ago, and she found the nine spot in her backyard in Oregon, and so I was able to fly out, and she was pointing it out to me. And it's great if you've ever been out with kids collecting, and you know this rare species is there, and so we're out in the yard, and she's like, "Wow!" And I'm like, "That's great!" And she's found one, and she says, "Look, it's a spider." And I said, "Oh, well, okay, good, but keep looking for the yeah." So, but eventually we found what we needed, and we brought those back, and were able to establish a colony. What has based on that? What have we found? And one of the things is that if you look at the pre release or pre-establishment of the 7 spot, which is a close cousin of the 9 spot, the 9 spot was ranked 3rd, and it had a relative abundance of 7%. Doesn't seem that high, but there's lots of ladybugs out there. So if you have a relative abundance across a lot of habitats of 7%, you're a player. Okay, back in pre-73, there were no 7 spots. Then if you come to the current time, the relative abundance actually now less than 1% and ranks down at 15th, which means you're sort of a also ran. And relative abundance of the 7 spot now 21%, and it's the second most common lady beetle behind only the Asian one. Okay, so we think that it's this species that has caused the decline of the 9 spot, or we think at least the timing lines up. So let's look at some of the experiments we've done to try to see, is that really the case? The timing is there for the 7 spot having had impact on the 9 spot, but does it really make, is there evidence for it? So one of the first things we found is that sometimes you get 9 spots that really only have 7 spots. There's variation. And sometimes you get a good 7 spot species, but it's got these 2 ghost spots on it, making it more like a 9. And so we started to wonder, maybe there's just a, it's not really good species, there's just a continuum of forms. And maybe they hybridized. And you're thinking, that's just wacky, species can't hybridize. Well, sometimes they do. Here is an endangered salamander and an introduced salamander. And when they mate, they can have viable offspring. And those viable offspring are actually the most fit, right? So you could get a hybrid that's replacing the native species. And you're saying, well, that can't happen with insects, but it can. And so you can get the viceroy and the white admiral, and again, it leads to a viable hybrid of the two. And we certainly see the spotted form and the spotless form. There's a spotless 9 spot. I know that seems counterintuitive. But when they mate, and so even though the forms look really different, they can mate and they can have viable offspring. Okay, so I often ask kids when I go out to different schools, what if a 9 spot and a 7 spot mated, what would you expect the offspring to be? So some people say 8, sometimes they say 16. But what do we actually find? Well, one thing, and I wasn't sure if everybody was going to be 21, so I covered this up. Okay. One thing we find is that, in fact, we found this in Oregon when we made one of those first collecting trips, that we put 9s and 7s in the same vial, and they started doing the nasty, the deed. They were going at it, okay? And so, just in case you don't believe it, I actually turn away if you're squeamish, okay? But so, the 9 spot and the 7 spot can absolutely make, I turn the sound down just because that would be, all right. Okay, so they can mate. And so clearly, here's the answer, right? We're going to have hybridization. And we're actually coming out with this this publication. And it turns out that not only is hybridization the key to lady beetle decline, it's also the key to colony collapse disorder, because we've found in the lab this lady beetle, and it's the hybrid of the two. Okay, not really. So that doesn't happen. So can they mate? Yes, absolutely. You've seen it. Can they hybridize? No. They do not produce. They'll lay eggs, but the eggs are never viable. But is there interference? And the answer to this, and there's a lot more data. In fact, Leo Stelweg could come and give a whole talk on this. But there's good evidence that even though they don't hybridize, that if a 9 spot female gets mated by a 7 spot male, she becomes less receptive to males of her own species. So some of her reproductive potential is being tied up. And so that means that there could be sort of a mating interference or reproductive interference that's one cause of why they're declining. And that can be more and more important as the nine spots, for whatever reason, get less and less common relative to the sevens, because the chance that they'll be courted by a seven-spot male goes higher and higher and higher. Okay. So possibility for interference, but not hybridization. Another thing that happens beyond the mating is that the nine-spot and the seven-spot have different life histories. And this is maybe not the, I could have done a more exciting graph from this paper, but this is the seven-spot, and this is two populations of the nine-spot. And the only point that I want to make here is that the seven-spot develops more quickly in the same temperatures, same diet. And so that could give it some sort of an edge in competitive interactions, right? Because if you are developing more quickly, it means you're getting bigger sooner. And in fact, if you look in the field, this isn't necessarily following one from the other, but here's what we find for collections in the field in terms of size of the nine spot. So P1s, meaning the ones that we directly collected from the field. The nine spots that you find in the field are smaller than the seven spots. They're also smaller than the nine spots' offspring. So if you bring them into the lab and feed them all they want, they grow up to be much larger than they are now in the field, which implies, and there's evidence to support that, I don't have time to develop here, but that they're being relegated to suboptimal habitats by the seven spot. And even if you look at the size of the nine spots that you collect now versus from a whole slew of collections, pinned specimens, they're smaller. So something is happening in the field to the size of the nine spots, and we know that there's a direct correlation between size and fecundity, right? So they're smaller, meaning they're going to have lower reproductive output. Okay, so what happens if you pair them up, right? And this is what Rakim Turnipseed did, another grad student in my lab. And this is a little bit hard to read, but this is, again, the western population and the eastern population. In the white circles, it's paired with C7 at low aphid density, and then this is C9 at high aphid density. I'll just cut to the chase here. When you rear a nine spot with a seven spot rather than a one of its own species, you get significantly lower survival rates of the nine spot. So it appears that there's good evidence for the nine spot being either outcompeted for food, or in many cases, this happens. All right, the fitness of this individual is low, right? And this is a very happy seven spot. This is a, well, it's not unhappy anymore, nine spot. And so, There's evidence then that based on the timing, based on potential reproductive interference, based on the differential life histories, and based on all of our competition studies, that the seven spot is actually outcompeting and sometimes eating the nine spot. So, oops, in that sense, these foreign lady beetles at least are bad hombres. Okay, so back to the original question. Are foreign lady beetles hardworking immigrants or bad hombres? And the answer is clearly yes. They are hardworking immigrants, and they're doing a lot of valuable biological control, but they're also bad hombres in the sense that they're coming into houses, coming on grapes, and they're apparently causing the decline of a lot of native species. So what based on that, what can we do? How should we react to that situation, knowing that they're here, we probably can't get rid of them. We not necessarily would want to, but yet we want to keep the diversity in the coccinellid complex. And so one of the things that's happened is just, this has been 2 years ago now, the New York DEC has made the nine-spot lady beetle and three others species of greatest conservation need. All right, so now in the state, it's listed as a species that is in need of conservation. More recently, this just happened about midway through last year, Canada, the Committee on the Status of Endangered Wildlife in Canada, recommended that the nine spot be listed as an endangered species in Canada. And what's cool is this is based partly on, in fact, I'll say mostly, on Lost Ladybug Project data, both from the US, and we have a lot of observations from Canada as well. So this is now, has gone to, the way it works there, this committee recommends it, and then it goes to a government agency that puts it out for comment from the different provinces, and we expect within 3 or 4 months, it'll actually be listed then there as an endangered species. Okay, so should we, based on this, what should our larger reaction be? Clearly, you don't really want predators, natural enemies coming in and wreaking havoc on the native species. So should we just stop doing this sort of biocontrol or really put heavy restrictions on it? And so I thought we should have some wisdom on this. So Ben Frank, this is often misquoted. So the question is, should we just give it up and not do it anymore? And so here's the actual quote from Ben. Those who give up essential pest suppression to obtain a little temporary safety deserve neither freedom from pests or safety. And see, he's actually releasing some ladybugs right there. Amazing that we got a color picture of that. So I would say that classical biological control is too valuable of a tool to just throw out, even though there's some evidence that there's bad interactions. And in a lot of cases, if you didn't have classical biological control, you'd be doing either just letting the pests go, and that could have impact on non-targets, or you're probably going to turn to something else like pesticides, which is going to have an interaction as well. So what should we do? Two things, at least two things to think about is testing, pre-testing of release that includes looking at impacts on other predators. That really, there wasn't much, if any, of that done. There's a really intense testing done if you're going to do an herbivore that you're going to release to control a plant, much less and much less structured if you're going to release something that's going after herbivores itself, like these ladybugs. Okay, so I call that extreme vetting of the predators that you might want to. I made that term up. I coined that myself. So the other thing we could do is conservation measures that will facilitate all lady beetle species. So rising tide raises all boats, right? So you've got the foreign ones here, you've got the native ones. If you did these conservation measures, you could help all those species. Now, Tony told me I had to include a weed science article in this talk. So here, this is an article that he and I just recently published. This was the cover, which is it's a figure from the paper, and I just want to point out this is the last hard copy cover of Weed Science ever, and this figure was drawn by an undergrad at Cornell. And and Christine was the main reason we got this done after 10 years. I should really recognize. This is an idea he and I had been kicking around but weren't able to get done until she came on board and whipped us into shape. So, but the point is that this looks at one possibility for conserving beneficials in the field is thinking about weeds not just as weeds, but also as a resource for these beneficial insects. And the idea is that based on conditions, you might actually shift what your level is that you're going to pull the trigger on using an herbivore on a weed, right? And by doing that, you can actually conserve a lot of the beneficial insects. Okay, I'll leave that. This could be a whole nother talk in itself, has been, in fact. Okay, another implication for conservation, redistribution of the rare species. Let's get them back out there. And we're looking at doing that by being able to sell at cost rare species that we raise in the lab to gardeners and organic growers especially. What time do...
1:10.
So I need to wrap it up sooner than later. Okay, all right. So let me just go... I have like another half hour really, but I'll wrap it up in 30 seconds. So those are all implications for sort of continental or the scale of the U.S. But there's also more of an international problem with Harmonia, and Harmonia being taking over. And this looks like fireworks, but really it just shows that now 50% of all lady beetles are Harmonia axeritis across the world. This is just a measure of called effective species, and it's a look at how much diversity there is and how much we're losing, okay? All that high density means that that Harmonia axeritis is at risk for, and actually people have identified two pathogens that could take this species down. If they do that, it could leave a real hole, and we could have a problem with pest suppression in that there might not be enough native species to take up the slack, right? So this is a food security risk. Okay, so what do we do for that? I talked about national implications, international implications, organize, collaborate, protect. We're working with the IUCN. We have a plan to try to do that internationally. We have started a specialist group. Wanted to point out especially our Russian member of the group. And why I wanted to point that out is because he works at the Vavilov Institute. Vavilov, one of the first people that looked at conservation of plants. Note all these people were at the Vavilov Institute. And I'll just do one more minute. The reason why I bring them up is because they were there when the Nazis came in 1941, siege of Leningrad. They were there in this huge storehouse of seeds and potatoes. They all these people starved to death rather than eating the seeds and potatoes to protect that diversity. Okay, so later, after they gave their lives to protect that. Vladimir Putin, in I think this is 2008, 2009, tried to get rid of that whole institute, and a lot of it was planted in trees that could never have been salvaged. Okay, so what happened is that Cornell and Polish researchers, along with huge petitions internationally, went out, and it was saved. They did not get rid of this institute. So my final message is, we are here facing a similar situation, right? And so it's time for us to speak out as well. And we've got huge problems that are international in scope, global in scope, global warming, loss of biodiversity. The only way we're going to solve those is by international collaboration. And if we don't speak out, we're not going to be able to do that. Okay, that's it.
Well, let's thank you.
Yeah.
There's the literature about conserving rare species and what that does in terms of ecosystem function, ecological function. And particularly in your case of looking at the 7 versus the 9 spotted, As I understand it, they have mostly the same niche space and they're doing similar functions. So what would be the detriment of this non-native replacing the native, other than the native isn't there anymore?
Yeah, and that's a reasonable question. And I think what one of the things that's happened is that we've gone from pre-establishment of the foreign species, with there was a really even and diverse set of native species. And we've gone from that in just a few decades to a complex that's completely dominated by two cosmopolitan species. And so in a strict biological control sense, there is no problem. In fact, maybe it's better. But I think the concern is that if anything ever happened to the two dominant species, there might not be enough diversity to take up the slack. If they were there and always doing their thing, it might not be so bad that you could make the argument, not clear yet, that they're not hitting all the niches as well as the diverse complex did. And certainly if they took a nosedive and went down the tubes, then you want to have enough diversity there to pick up the slack. So the idea is that a lot of times you can have a invasive come in, the natives tank, but then eventually they re-equilibrate. And so if we could assist that recovery, then we might get back to a more stable state for something which we don't know is ever going to happen, but we think is a risk. Does that make sense? Yeah.
So just touching on that, assisting the recovery part of it, I don't really know how decisions are made in terms of who gets released where. Maybe it's how many aphids per square centimeter you can eat in a given time. But what you're doing with rearing in the lab, are they natives harder to rear, harder to get? Why aren't they more part of release systems than some of these bat hombre?
Right. And that's a good question. And so there are no foreign ones being released anymore, foreign lady beetles. The foreign ones were specifically brought over because there were, first it was Russian wheat aphid mostly for the seven spot, and it was a number of, the Harmonia was supposed to go after pests on sort of woody ornamentals. So the idea with why they were brought in is not because they were easier to rear, but because they were seen as more voracious and maybe more attuned to these foreign pests that were on foreign crops. They're about equally easy to rear. What you find now, if you Google and you want to buy ladybugs and to release them, all the ladybugs that you are going to get are one species, Hippodamia convergens, a native species that's all collected in the mountains of California. They go over and they estivate up in those mountains in the summer, and people come with these bucket things and just scoop them up by the thousands, right? And that's okay, except there are several problems with using those as opposed to maybe trying to re-release these rare ones. One is they don't work very well. They just fly off and they don't tend to suppress the pests very well. Two is that they're in such high density numbers they could introduce diseases around the country. And the third is that there's concern that by just releasing them from this one area that they're adapted to, that they're going to spread suboptimal genes, you know. So when we do our rear and sales and release program, what we're doing is, it's called the local ladybug project, is we have populations from about five places and we're rearing them, and so you're always getting the ladybugs hopefully more locally adapted than the California ones.
Okay, with that, let's thank John for a
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.